Bob Parry, investigative reporter for Newsweek magazine. Now that we've had a couple of days to look at Tower Commission report, what's left in all this?
Well, there's a good deal. The Tower Commission, with its mandate to review the National Security Council, did focus on that, and they focused primarily on the Iran side of this equation, which still leaves Congress and the independent counsel to look at the Contra side of the equation more deeply. There is some new material about the Contra side in this report, but it's not nearly as definitive as the question of how the Iran arms sales developed.
Where we are right now, do you think that there will be a long, detailed investigation that will continue to interest the American people?
Well, it's hard to say what will interest the American people. I think there's still a great deal to come out, and the degree to which the White House became involved in questionable activities is still to be resolved.
It's the first item of business that the two committees will get into as soon as they begin the hearings. And do you know when they're going to start the hearings?
Well, it's not clear, but I think people are talking about later on in the spring.
There's a report in this morning's Wall Street Journal, one of the many stories, talks about, let's see if I can get the headline here on it. Says that Iranians made arms payments of $87 million. Report says some provided middlemen on U.S. sales exceeds early estimates. And this is talking about $87 million that was collected by arms merchant Ghorbanifar. Are there a lot of stories like this in the Tower Commission report that we haven't seen yet?
Well, the Tower Commission report has a lot of detail which has not all been sifted through yet. There are indications that this was a more elaborate more detailed arrangement than people have known. The information in here about Colonel North's role is fascinating. The kind of communications that were being passed on, the degree of almost exhaustion that was being brought upon the National Security Council staff trying to juggle all these policies at one time. But there probably are some nuggets that have not yet been mined in the report.
Got in front of me Newsweek magazine for this is actually the cover issue of March 9th. Reagan's failures, can he recover? And also then I have last week's issue, which has cover-up and also a photograph of Ronald Reagan. It's unusual for Newsweek to have the President of the United States on the cover 2 weeks in a row.
Well, I would say that's true. I think the there was a certain similarity to the covers, but it's hard to avoid that. This is a news magazine, and the president clearly was the big news figure the last 2 weeks.
Looking at last week's issue, the March 2nd issue, to protect the president, NSC staffers say Don Regan ordered them to conceal the early approval of arms sales to Iran by Ronald Reagan. This week, the Tower Commission will tell how the president changed his story. Now Reagan must fight to save his presidency. Does that pretty well track with what happened?
With what, in terms of?
The Tower Commission, did they report as you had predicted they would?
Well, we didn't really predict. I mean, the information we had about the NSC staffers saying that that Don Regan had ordered the cover-up, we never said would be in the Tower Commission report. There is some reference to it. McFarland does say that it was Don Regan who ordered the chronology, which turned out to be false. But there's still more to come out, and in the case of the NSC staff, two key principals, Poindexter and North, have yet to testify.
Last time we visited with you just a couple months ago, you were at the Associated Press, where you'd been since 1974. What's the difference in the way you approach this story now that you're with Newsweek than when you were with AP?
Well, mostly, and it's been 2 weeks that I've been with Newsweek, mostly you have just more time to deal with things. You're not in the constant rush of getting stories out. At AP, of course, you have, as they say, the deadline every minute, and you're constantly in that situation of when to file and how much more you should report on. At Newsweek, the crunch comes more at the end of the week when the magazine's being put together.
Is there a specific difference, like if you write copy for the Associated Press, does it go right under the wire versus when you write copy for, say, Newsweek, does it go into an editor and then into the magazine?
Well, it certainly goes to an editor at the AP, too, and it would be reviewed and edited as they feel necessary. At Newsweek, clearly, there's more massaging of stories. The information goes up to writers in New York. They rework it as they feel it should be reworked.
Have your little the byline section right down here at the end. I don't know if you can see it right there. It says Jerry Adler with Margaret Gerard Warner and Robert Parry in Washington. And I want to move back a little bit and show our audience exactly what this story is. How'd you put this together? This is a story about Fawn Hall. And who, explain to our audience they don't know by now who she is.
Well, Fawn Hall, of course, was Colonel North's secretary at the National Security Council. And she is the the first known witness to be granted immunity by the independent counsel. And she has told, she's provided information, according to sources, that that she was ordered to help destroy some documents and to alter others. The way that story is put together is that I called a number of people, as did Margaret Warner, and we talked, we developed information. We filed it to New York, and then it's rewritten there.
We see a picture of her here in the magazine this week, and down at the bottom it says, accidental celebrity. Is this a new or an old picture?
I presume that's a photograph from her her modeling portfolio. She is a part-time model.
This is the photo we showed just earlier here, and I want to, if you move back just a little bit, Ann, to show where the gentleman behind her has his arms around Fawn Hall. Who is he?
Well, that's Arturo Cruz Jr., the son of one of the two leaders of the United Nicaraguan opposition. He is a he lives in Washington. He's he in his own right is a contra figure. He has been part of what you might call the reform side of the contra movement.
What do you think of her? Have you met her?
Yes, I met her once accidentally. I was with someone and I in Old Town and stumbled upon her at a bar in Old Town, and we chatted for a while. She seems to be a very composed, bright young lady.
And what will her testimony, what effect will her testimony have on the whole stories that you've seen so far?
Well, she was an assistant to North, in effect. She was much more than what one might think a secretary would be. She is not simply a person who types or answers the phone. She was a person who managed Colonel North's day. She was involved in writing letters to individuals in the private aid network. She was more of an administrative assistant than I think one might think of with her job title.
Any surprises in the Tower Commission report about Lieutenant Colonel North?
Well, I think the biggest surprise I saw was how exhausted he seemed to be and how much pressure he seemed to be under. There are references, repeated references, to how he felt that he was exhausted, how he felt he needed help in carrying this out, how he was not getting enough sleep. Very personal kinds of anecdotes about the difficulty he faced in trying to essentially run a secret foreign policy that was being held, that was being kept from not just Congress and the American public, but from people inside the executive branch.
We have a couple of lines open in the West, and we'll go to the phones in about 7 minutes. The numbers, as you can see, are on your screen. We're talking with Bob Parry, who is an investigative reporter with Newsweek magazine. Here's the front page of Monday's New York Times. A photograph here of Robert McFarlane, along with his daughter Melissa over here on the left, and his wife Jonda. McFarlane, suicide attempt, what drove me to despair? Are you surprised that this whole event is such a public matter? This is his first on-the-record interview.
Well, I think clearly Mr. McFarlane was distressed by what had occurred over the past several years and what was coming out. He plays a pivotal role in terms of starting the Iran initiative. I'm sure he felt in retrospect that he made some mistakes, and that's always a hard thing to face up to.
How did he come out?
I think in the commission report he came out better than one might have expected. He's a person who clearly who acknowledges that he misrepresented the facts. In particular, in regard with the chronology that was prepared after the story began to break, the chronology made an effort to present the president as not having provided approval for the initial Israeli sales in the summer of 85. McFarlane acknowledges that that was not accurate.
Here's another photograph from Newsweek. The Reagan endgame, Nancy Reagan. This is in this week's issue. And on the back page of the Wall Street Journal is a rather extensive piece written by Jane Mayer. Nancy Reagan's behind-the-scenes maneuvering stands out in circumstances of Reagan's ouster. How do you read this story? Not this particular one, but the whole Nancy Reagan story.
Well, Nancy Reagan has a great deal of influence inside the White House, and with clearly her regular communications with the president gives anyone the kind of that, you know, a great deal of influence. But she's also been very protective of the president, and she has sought to look out for his interests as she sees them. And when she reached the conclusion that that Don Reagan was a threat to those interests, she sought to ease him out, and she was the point person for that effort.
Has the media been used a lot during this process? A couple of days ago, you saw a front page piece in the Washington Post and the front page piece in the New York Times, all about Don Regan and the episode about the hanging up of the phone and all that behind the scenes.
Has the media been used? The media is always used. There's always an attempt by politicians to get their case out as effectively as possible in the news media. Overall, I would say that in regard to this, the Iran and Contra story, the media probably has not earned very good marks by being on top of things overall.
I'm reading now from Jane Mayer's story. Mrs. Regan, who is credited with being a shrewd judge of character, apparently bet right. In December and January, the Regan camp tried fighting back largely through the news media. Who do you think in this whole process has been the most effective? And undoubtedly, you watched how different people in the story have used the media. Who do you think has been the most effective?
In terms of inside the White House?
Using the media the best, getting the best leaks out there so that their case can, you know, the public will side with their case or will have the end result.
Well, this White House has been extraordinarily effective in general over the past 6 years in getting its case out and in doing what they call spin control. Some call it perception management. The White House has sought, using some very sophisticated techniques, to convey how it sees the world and how it feels the public should see the world. To some degree, its success has been so great that the news media has not been able to hold this administration to a level of fact that I think it probably should have. And to some degree, what has happened with this crisis in Washington has to be traced back to the failure of the news media to keep an eye on both the Contra program, which was developing secretly out of the White House, and then later the Iran program.
Another story that's all over the papers this morning, I'm trying to find USA Today front page, is a story of Howard Baker enters fray today to Reagan's side. Former Senator Howard Baker takes over today as presidential chief of staff. I'm meeting with my transition team the first thing in the morning. Tough task, fix damaged presidency. Your reaction to this appointment?
Well, clearly, Howard Baker has a great deal of credibility in Washington and is regarded as a very decent and able man. And it probably, in a political sense, was a very good choice. Whether or not he can repair the damage to this presidency is another question. It's almost hard to believe, having been here as recently as 4 months ago, looking at this this White House and this administration and how strong they appeared, how almost invincible they were, and the arrogance I think that may have bred inside the White House, that they could do anything they wanted and get away with it. Now suddenly, 4 months into this scandal, they are now very vulnerable. There's even talk about whether the president should resign.
In this morning's New York Times, the First Lady stages a coup is the headline here on William Safire's column. At a time he most needs to appear strong, President Reagan is being weakened and made to appear wimpish and helpless by the political interference of his wife. Nancy Reagan's campaign to force her husband to fire White House Chief of Staff Don Regan has been crowned with a success. With extraordinary vindictiveness, the First Lady issued a gleeful victory statement when her target was brought down. Conservative columnist Bill Safire, what's your reaction to that statement?
Well, it's hard to say whether or not it was right or wrong for Nancy Reagan to be happy about Don Regan leaving. Clearly, any observer of the White House, I think, at this point would say that the president has to make a clean break with the past. He must make a clean break with the way things have been run for the past several years. And Don Regan was clearly part of that. And to think of him reorganizing his presidency in a way that will regain credibility with the American public, with Don Regan still in charge, is hard to conceive. Clearly, this was a move that I think most political observers would have agreed was necessary.
Back to the issue of the media. Bill Safire writes, Mrs. Reagan has a coterie of media biggies in whom she regularly confides. They passed on her drumfire of criticism of staff chief who dared to refuse to defer to her advice. She was then able to display the ensuing reports to the president as evidence that his chief of staff had become an intolerable burden On matters of patronage, she has been a powerhouse. Through her best friend, Mary Jane Wick, she controls jobs, trips, and honors at USIA and is arranging a post-administration Reagan social presence in Washington by replacing Roger Stevens with Charles Wick as head of the Kennedy Center. Is she unusually adept at using the media? Is she known to have a lot of media friends?
The First Lady? Well, I think she has gotten better at this. I mean, if you recall back in when the president first took office back in 81, she had a great deal of difficulty. She was perceived widely as being a First Lady who cared more about the frills of the White House and Washington than about the substance. She bought new china. She redecorated the White House. That effort hit up some of the president's wealthy friends in Texas and California to pay for it. There was an image of Nancy Reagan as someone who cared about fancy gowns. She's overcome that. You know, she did it, I think, rather assiduously by developing, by working on the drug programs that she's interested in, and by reaching out to the news media rather quietly and discreetly, but effectively.
Our guest, as it's time to go to the phones, is Bob Parry, who's an investigative reporter for this magazine, Newsweek. He was with the Associated Press since 1974, was an investigative reporter for the last 5 years. Is originally from Hartford, Connecticut. He's not married, has a Bachelor of Arts in English from Colby College in 1971. Here's what the inside looks like. Here's a photograph of President Reagan and the Tower Commission namesake, John Tower, former senator from Texas. Time to go to the phones. Our first call comes from Stamford, Connecticut. Go ahead, please.
I think that President Reagan should resign. He hasn't been capable of running the country for the whole 6 years, I think. He's delegated his work to his staff and to his aides, and all he's done is put on a big show of being president.
Do you have a question for Bob Parry about this Tower Commission that we have here in our hands?
Yes, I'm wondering why a lot of members of Congress say that he can make a comeback when they know, and they've known for a long time, that he's not capable of running the country.
Thank you. Do you think the president can make a comeback?
Well, I think this caller has a fair point. It is going to be very difficult for the president to make a comeback. And I don't think anyone believes that he will ever achieve the level of power and influence that he had prior to the scandal breaking out. He was perceived as a forceful, effective leader. Much of that, it's quite clear, was in image making and not in substance. The overall remarkable statement made by the Tower Commission report is that it presents the president and his top advisors essentially arguing what might be called the Reagan defense. It's almost a defense of diminished capacity. It's that that the president was, even though he was, according to the report, involved, in some ways energetically involved in certain aspects of this program, that he has forgotten his role. There is testimony from Bud McFarlane in here about how excited the president seemed about this initiative with Iran. Yet now the president says he doesn't remember what he did with it. Yes, I mean, that's a very serious problem for the president. I don't think the American public feels comfortable with the fact that the president cannot remember making important decisions. But whether or not he can turn that around and by removing some of his some of the people who were in his White House, who contributed to this problem, can still draw from that reservoir of goodwill, which I think he still has out there, is still to be seen.
Van Nuys, California, for Bob Parry of Newsweek. Go ahead, please.
Yes, thank you for taking my call this morning. I was amazed at some of the interviewing that I saw yesterday on, if you don't mind me mentioning, on the David Brinkley show, Sam Donaldson inquiring of Senator Tower. Some of the basic facts or some findings of their commission. Namely, I think we've all found somewhat smoking gun, if not one that's recently been fired, with the memo that apparently North had sent requesting a signature or an approval from President Reagan as to contra funding. When Mr. Tower was vigorously questioned about this, he reverted back to basically defending the president, actually almost reading the mind of the president. Now, Sam Donaldson asked him, How do you know that President Reagan was not aware of this memo? And you know, Senator Tower said, well, you know, we didn't find any proof that he was. And Sam Donaldson said, did you ask Admiral Poindexter? No, we didn't get a chance to interview him. Then after numerous attempts of asking, did you ask the president, did he know of this memo? Did he know of this memo? Finally, Tower just, you know, in a very defensive posture said, no, he didn't know anything about it. And I find that if there's going to be one bit of evidence that may explode, it might be this one particular memo. If the American people ever find out that any of this money was diverted to conservative organizations, a la Mr. Channel's group, in this country, to provide funding either for fighting anti-Contra funding senators or groups, it's going to be something much bigger than Watergate. It's going to be something that strikes at the craw of every American. I don't care if it's conservative or liberal. And I think, I'm making a prediction here, but I truly do feel before this president's administration is over, he will have to resign, and possibly Mr. Bush will as well. I'd like to comment from Mr. Parry. I do enjoy your articles, by the way. Thank you.
Thank you. And on our screen right now is an article from this morning's New York Times. Fundraiser linked to Iran deal says to be seeking audits, and this is Carl Channel.
Well, the first question, the question was about the memo that was found in Colonel North's files, which was intended for the president, and it did talk about the Iran initiative, and made reference in the body of the memo to the diversion of aid to the Contras. Now, as Senator Tower says, it is not clear at this point whether or not that was conveyed to the president. The president denies that he saw it. We still have, however, two key witnesses who would have been between that memo and the president who have not spoken out. And those two witnesses, of course, are Admiral Poindexter and Colonel North. Now, should one of them say, yes, indeed, we brought that to the president and he signed off on it or gave us oral approval, that would change the picture immensely. We will also find out that there was at least one other memo that was not included in the Tower Commission report that refers to North's plan to brief the president on the Contra funding operation, not necessarily the Iran portion, but on the fact that Colonel North was secretly running this program of aid to the Contras. It is not clear from that documentation either whether or not this briefing actually occurred. But should we find out that the president had intimate knowledge of either the diversion question or the fact that there was this extensive program operating inside the White House to funnel support to the Contras, I think the nature of this scandal, the nature of this problem, will change dramatically.
Jacksonville, Florida. Go ahead, please.
Good morning, Brian.
Morning.
First of all, if I could just tell you that, and you're probably aware of this, that you have some callers who call every day, particularly one I recognize his voice out in Tucson, Arizona. But I have two questions for your guests. First, I'd like to make a brief statement. The other day, Senator Jesse Helms appeared on the Evans Novak television program, and he said that he was positively assured that President Reagan knew all along about this Contra fund diversion and that kind of thing. And he said because the reason he knows Ronald Reagan. My question is, does it really make any difference whether the president knew or not, since these are his aides that he appointed to wait these funds if it turns out that way? And why are we carrying this thing to these conclusions that the president didn't know about it?
Thank you.
Well, that's a fair question. Is a president responsible for what his aides do? Clearly, the president's aides went off and did some things which have not been very popular with the American public since they've come out. They may also be illegal. That is what the independent counsel is delving into at this time. But the overall question is it possible that the president would not have known significant information about the Contra funding program that was being run out of the White House? The Iran diversion may have been a short-term deal. It may have started in the spring of 86 and been wrapped up in the space of 6 months. The Contra funding program, which North was managing from the White House, went on for 2 years. Is it possible that all this could have happened without the president having a fairly clear knowledge of it? That's of course still to be determined. But whether or not he's responsible overall for what his staff does is really a question the American people have to decide as to what they expect from their president and what they don't. One point I would differ with the Tower Commission on is their assessment of what the laws on the Contra-Aid program were. The Tower Commission takes a rather, I think, an odd view of what those laws said. The Tower Commission says that the laws were unclear as to what could be done at different times. While there was some uncertainty about what the restrictions were, they were not nearly as uncertain as the Tower Commission suggests. For instance, the Tower Commission says that that there was a question as to whether the National Security Council staff was covered by the so-called Bowen Amendment, which barred any entity of the U.S. government involved in intelligence from assisting the Contras militarily. The fact of the matter is that in a September 85 letter to Congress from Bud McFarlane, the National Security Council acknowledges that indeed it was covered by the Bowen Amendment.
San Diego, next for Bob Parry of Newsweek. Go ahead, please.
Yes, good morning. I'm calling you from San Diego, California. I have learned more about politics since watching C-SPAN than any other time in my lifetime. I'm now 61. I also tell my friends to watch, but it disturbs me greatly when watching the Senate investigations that our country has lost control in our governing by allowing a president to sit back and not monitor the most valued thing we have, our freedom to vote and live in a marvelous country such as ours.
Question for Bob Parry?
The question is why?
Okay, thank you.
Why?
Why does a country lay back and let a president do this? Why does the Senate
do it?
Well,
I mean, obviously that's a very good question. I mean, there may have been a failure over the past 6 years of our democratic process. I mean, the public has not seemed to have a burning interest in what the government's up to. The public seems willing to accept in general terms the image of a strong presidency. The Congress, partly because of the popularity of this president, did not seem willing to challenge him on points of fact and points of interest to the American people. And the press, likewise, did not aggressively pursue the facts of this administration. And I'm not quite sure what happened, but it seemed that maybe the feeling of that we'd been through too much as a country, that it was time to have a respite from investigations and controversy, that President Reagan's great success was that he made the American people feel good about themselves again, that he allowed them to stand tall, as he would put it. Maybe those things prevented us from being careful in terms of examining what this administration was actually doing. And I would agree that there perhaps was, in general anyway, a failure of our various checks and balances to keep an eye on things.
Knoxville, Tennessee, go ahead, please.
Yes, good morning. Enjoy C-SPAN very much.
Thank you.
Great service to the country. A couple of things bother me about this thing, though. One of the main things is I heard Senator Moynihan say just 2 weeks ago on the air, it may have been that Sunday morning show on ABC, I'm not sure, but he said that he thought this smoking gun in this situation was exactly where this other caller this morning had stated it was, that that money from this, ill-gotten money from this arms sale went into domestic politics, primarily into the campaign of someone in California whose campaign manager is Pat Buchanan's sister. And I hope that the press is working on this, because this is the smoking gun that'll bring down the presidency. There's no doubt about it. A couple of other quick observations. I got out some of my material yesterday from back during the pre-80 election. And one of the most brutal savagings of that election was the conservative, led by Phyllis Schlafly and others, the conservative attack on Rosalynn Carter for her participation in the Carter administration. She was criticized as being too activist of a first lady, too involved in first lady politics, and there were some vicious things written about her. And yet here, now we have the spectacle of Nancy Reagan, an unelected member of the White House, bringing all kinds of influence, and yet there's a thunderous silence on the right. We don't hear any conservatives complaining about her participation in this battle with Reagan at all. And my third thing is saying, my last thing is that about this thing of America standing tall, I never considered beating up on Grenada as something to make us all feel a lot of pride, but I'll tell you one thing that does make me feel terrible as an American. the fact that these gentlemen sat in, I've seen the documents printed in the paper here, I'm pretty sure this is a true thing that happened. They had a conscious discussion in the White House as to whether or not to kill Gaddafi's family. And they decided it would be good to go ahead and attempt to kill his family because it would strip him of some of his macho. It would prove to the public that he was not able to protect his family. This kind of the attack on a man's family, attempting to kill, is so unworthy of America and what we like to think we stand for. How could anyone stand tall if we think we're out there making war on people's children? I don't care about what they do with Gaddafi.
Okay, sir, I'm going to let you go at that point and let Bob Parry respond. Thank you.
Well, the first question had to do with the political funding. Now, I think that is there's general agreement that if indeed money from the Iranian arms sales was funneled into the American political process, that would deepen this scandal immensely. Americans certainly do not like the idea of foreign money being used to tilt elections or try to influence how they think when it's being done surreptitiously. But at this point, and this is being looked at fairly carefully by a number of reporters in the press, and it will be looked at carefully by the congressional committees. But there's at this point has not been substantial evidence to prove that. It is certainly a suspicion, and it's something that people are working on. As far as the Gaddafi matter, I think you're referring to Seymour Hersh's piece in the Sunday Times a couple weeks ago. Perhaps a almost more disturbing question about that was the nature of the intelligence on Gaddafi's alleged role in the West Berlin disco bombing. That article raises serious questions that the United States had good intelligence on that. That the intelligence that we did have was rushed to be used for the purpose of striking back. Some people who have seen the evidence suggest that it really points more to Syria, but that Syria was not as easy a target, not as popular a target, as was Gaddafi. So Gaddafi was chosen.
Seattle, Washington, for Bob Parry of Newsweek. Go ahead, please.
Yes, Mr. Parry, I wonder if you have in your pipelines any people who are criticizing or commenting on the cynicism of the Republican Party in running Ronald Reagan not just once, but twice, when they knew that Ronald Reagan was essentially lazy, essentially detached from the job. There's a great deal of cynicism that makes me feel that I could never trust the people who are now in charge of the machinations of the Republican Party. Somebody has to write the editorial that says the blame really goes right to those businessmen, Republican organizers who let such a man into our government. Could you comment on that?
Well, I think it's not perhaps fair to blame the Republican Party for the selection of candidates any more than it's fair to blame the Democratic Party for the selection of their candidates. The political process has been thrown open. There are primaries, there are caucuses, there are ways for the American people now to have a great deal more influence over who is chosen to run for the major parties. The fact that Ronald Reagan was a very adept politician and that he was able to win the support of not just Republicans but of the country as by huge margins as a whole suggests that there probably are not kingpins in the Republican Party who could have stopped him and said, no, you're not going to do this. The failure, in a sense, goes more to the American people and to the ability of the of politicians these days to use public relations techniques to sell themselves in ways that might not be actually accurate. And the American public and the press has failed to be careful enough in trying to measure people against reality as opposed to against the images that they're able to create of themselves. And I think that if there's any real lesson here, and it should be a lesson to all of those of us who take part in this process, is that one must try to find out what the facts really are. One must try to find out if indeed this person who seems to be standing tall, seems to be standing up against terrorism, seems to be doing these things, actually is. And there should be a demand from the public, of its press, and of its politicians in Congress, that they do oversight, that they seriously examine things and try to present the hard facts to the American people. But as I say, I think there was a failure of all the checks and balances here. That And the ironic and sad thing is that if the press had done its job better, and if the public had been more demanding that the press do its job better, the White House might have been protected. It's possible that these problems might have been stopped at an earlier stage. And in that case, we would not have ended up with the kind of scandal we have now.
Let me put you on the spot a little bit. There's an ad in this morning's New York Times. You said that the press had been out ahead. Here is Newsweek in an ad taking a little credit for the whole thing, week by week, out front of the biggest story of the Reagan presidency. Going back to November of 86, you can see here where you have the Ayatollah, Mr. Reagan in November, Mr. Reagan in December, Mr. Reagan again in December, Mr. McFarlane, Mr. Reagan, Mr. Reagan. When the Iran scandal first broke, Newsweek broke with it. We've stayed with it like no other news magazine, because when it comes to major news events, no one goes after the story like Newsweek, answering the questions, questioning the answers, keeping you ahead of the story.
Well, I think the press has done a very good job in terms of the major media. Once the scandal broke, I think it's true that Newsweek did a good job, and I think it's true that the New York Times and the Washington Post and other major news media have devoted incredible resources to finding out what the nature of this Iran deal was, how it tied into the Contra funding, and so forth. The real question has to be, though, what about the previous 6 years? What was being done then in terms of keeping an eye on these things? How did they get this far? I reported back in the summer of 85 about North being involved with the private aid network, and there were a few people who were, but it was really a very small number of reporters, and there wasn't a tremendous amount of interest in the major news media to examine how our foreign policy was being taken over by a small group in the National Security Council working directly for the president and in a way that was unaccountable to Congress.
Chesterton, Indiana, for Bob Parry. Go ahead, please.
Well, good morning, Brian.
Morning.
And I hope you give me equal time with this man. I just paid for about 3 minutes of his speech, which we've all heard ad nauseum for the last 6 months. The Tower Commission emphatically stated, this is known as selective listening here, emphatically stated that there was absolutely no evidence of funds being diverted to local political groups. But it's such a juicy one to talk about, we're going to wring this dry, okay? Now, also, there's a little thing you don't need to forget. Right in the midst of Watergate, where it was extremely smelly, Mr. Nixon was reelected, so how in the hell you can read the American people's mind, I really don't know. An awful lot of this stuff goes over people's heads. Now, there's something else that I have been noticing lately. This is the things that the press doesn't notice. Nobody sees. Maybe they do notice. Who knows? But, you know, Gucci Gorby is going to be real, real generous. He's going to consent to our original offer or whatever it was on the missiles. But you know what he's been hearing? What he's been hearing for 6 months, President Reagan is on the ropes. SDI will never go through now. The Contra aid is kaput. Now, of course, if Congress was to vote against SDI under other circumstances, the American people would cut their throats. But how about it, Mr. Gorby? We don't want SDI. Save our bacon, and you have nothing to lose anyway, because SDI won't go through. Let's look good. You know, that's a real winner. Nobody sees this. This is important. We are not going to examine these offers, obviously.
All right, Chesterton, there's your equal time, Mr. Parry.
Well, on the point about the political funding, I mean, it's also certainly true that the Tower Commission said, we're not the last answer, that there's much we couldn't do, they say. They say they received much of the information late. They clearly do not have all the answers and don't pretend to. What they were trying to do, and they went somewhat beyond their mandate. Their mandate was to look at the National Security Council apparatus and whether it served the president well or didn't. And they did a very good job at that. They also went beyond that to look at certain aspects of the scandal that had not been looked at before, or not in the depth that they did. But they made it quite clear that they felt that there were many questions that they did not answer and could not answer based on the time and information they had.
Hermiston, Oregon, go ahead, please.
Thank you, Brian. I think that C-SPAN's the greatest. I wanted to say first that Reagan is he's got the best show right now that he's ever had. not the Defense Department. I think we're in worse shape now than what we was in with Nixon's situation. And as far as the Tower Commission is concerned, how can you appoint a commission that will see what's going on or do their share when the president appointed them himself? Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, I think the Tower Commission proved to most people's satisfaction that it was an honest broker in this. It's not to say that they don't have people they like perhaps more than others, and they don't have some biases. But I think the general reading of the Tower Commission report was that it was a fairly tough, honest document. There are things people disagree with about it. There are things that there were some shortcomings in it. There were some relatively small mistakes made in the haste to get it out. But I don't think you'll find many people in Washington feeling that these three gentlemen behaved in a way that was, not fair and impartial.
Any differences between the way Mr. Muskie approached the issue and the other two?
It's hard to tell exactly what was going on inside the commission. I think they all worked together and did a very commendable job.
Princeton, New Jersey, go ahead, please. You're on with Bob Parry.
How can you investigate this story using other things besides White House documentation?
Do you understand the question?
No.
Could you embellish on that a little bit?
All of the facts have come out through White House documents.
In other words, you're not comfortable yet feeling you had enough information?
No. I think most of them are prefabricated.
Okay.
Well, it clearly is a problem that the commission recognized, that they were, and it was one of the limitations they had on their work. They worked essentially from a base of information that came from computer messages that were sent to different people inside the National Security Council, the so-called profs. These profs were only sent to people inside the National Security Council because those were the people who were on the computer system. For instance, there would be no messages sent on that computer system to the Vice President or to the Secretary of State or to the Secretary of Defense. So you'd have a limitation in terms of what the information is. But as I said before, the Tower Commission was dealing with essentially the National Security Council and how it served the President. It was therefore working from information it had from the National Security Council and acknowledges that there's still much to be done.
Needles, California. Next. Go ahead, please.
Good morning. One quick question to Brian. I wanted to know why he asked you, Mr. Parry, why Mr. Muskie should have taken a different position possibly in there. And secondly, I would like to ask Mr. Parry from Newsweek, does he think that most of the people around the country actually understand the Tower Commission report and what it was supposed to have done in the first place? And secondly, I would like to ask Mr. Parry, doesn't he honestly and truthfully, as a rather matter-of-factly, think the liberals in this country, particularly in the political arena, are using the media to foster their own political ambitions and to destroy the presidency? Is it not our system set up the way it is that makes our presidency very vulnerable and consequently can very easily be destroyed? And I think that finally that I would like to suggest that news media concern themselves, and particularly Newsweek and the New York Times, to concern themselves maybe with some of the other problems around the world also, namely South African apartheid.
Okay, thank you. Answering your first question to me, I ask him the question about Mr. Muskie, because Mr. Muskie's a Democrat and the other two are Republicans.
Well, what was the other question he wanted?
What do you think the American people's perception of what the charge was for the Tower Commission?
Well, I think as far as the charge was, I mean, it was, and it may not be fully understood, that the commission was supposed to be dealing with the NSC staff. But in terms of the vulnerability of the presidency and whether or not liberals are taking advantage of this, I would say that politicians always take advantage of what they can politically. On the other hand, it is true that this president has had 6 years of almost unparalleled success in dealing both with the American public and with Congress, and also with the press. And if it had not been for what the kind of mistakes that are outlined in the Tower Commission report, this president would not be in the kind of trouble he's in at all. I mean, it was really a case of the White House staff going essentially on its own to carry out policies that were kept in secret, that were not authorized by Congress, that were not known by the American people, that caused this president difficulty. And that is not just a political swipe at the president. It's a question of how the government operates and how he operates as president.
Here's from the Washington Times this morning, a cartoon by Garner, self-explanatory. Moline, Illinois, go ahead, please.
Morning, gentlemen.
Morning.
Two quick comments, two quick questions. Nancy Reagan did just what any normal wife would do. Also, a book that's out at the moment called Inside the League by Scott and John Lee Anderson, two investigative reporters, will show that our favorite ally, Israel, is into this up to her eyeballs, which seems to be escaping comment today. All right, two questions. Where is the intellect when we give intelligentsia and weaponry to both warring nations to kill each other off? I just can't quite get that. Second, Mr. Parry, you touched on it. The American people don't seem to care one iota about the information having to come about Boesky and about this Iran-Contra flap from overseas. This news medium evidently must be controlled in this nation, is there anything I can see, because they have sure been asleep at the wheel. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, I think the news media does have to take some of the heat for this failure. It was a case, and I'm not quite sure all of what went into it, but we were dealing with an extremely popular president, and I think there was a sense in the news media that the press did not want to be out of step with the American public. It did not want to be seen as unpatriotic. It did not want to be seen as damaging another president. The press was attacked rather severely for its roles in Watergate and its roles in covering the Vietnam War, and I think there was fear that the press would again be attacked for undermining the presidency or undermining a foreign policy initiative. The press was also being criticized whenever it did try to find out some information along those lines of spreading disinformation, even when the information was correct, of aiding and abetting foreign enemies, even when the press was really after trying to tell the truth to the American people. So there were attacks against the press. The press was very sensitive. The press was dealing with a very popular president. But the bottom line is that the press did not hold this presidency to the facts, did not examine the undertakings of this White House in a careful and thorough way, and it contributed to what is now an explosive scandal that is rocking the presidency again, in a sense, by trying to not hold this president to reality, we allowed, to a degree, this mess to occur.
Radium Springs, New Mexico. Go ahead, please.
Good morning.
Morning.
Thank you, C-SPAN. If you have all the money in the world and have all the things that you need, what is the next thing you want to do? You want to have power. A group of multimillionaires in California selected Reagan to represent them for power. He had no background at all in politics, but he was very presentable and could make a good speech, and they made him governor of California. Then they decided when the time was right, and Carter was at a low, they ran him and they got him through as a Republican candidate. He has never made a decision. He has never said anything on his own. His press conferences are at the minimum because every time he said something from the helicopter to the White House and vice versa, they had to correct it. He has been controlled and run. It got out of control.
Question, caller? You have a question for our guest, please?
Well, what I want to know is, why isn't somebody investigating how all this came about?
Okay, thank you. Mr. Parry?
Well, that goes back a ways, I suppose. It's probably true that every politician has his financial backers. Every politician has political interest groups that he is beholden to. And I'm sure in that sense President Reagan is no different. But it's also clear that this man won elections, and won elections by wide margins. It is just too easy and too pat to say that some wealthy businessman in California put him in the White House. It was a case of the American public on two occasions by large majorities electing him to the White House. And that just can't be, it's too easy to dismiss it as some kind of conspiracy. It wasn't.
Houston, Texas, for Bob Parry.
Hello?
You're on the air.
Okay. Yes, I would like to say about Grenada. United States have a vicious attitude towards black people, and the thing that really disturbs me is we stay in the Caribbean and see our brothers came from America to kill our brothers over there.
Connor, how does this relate to our subject this morning about the Iran situation?
Because what really happened to this country here, the leader of this country here have teach the people, have programmed the people to behave just like they are and just like they had lived all their life, fighting and killing people.
Okay, thank you. You agree with the gentleman?
Well, not necessarily, but clearly there is a lot to be said about how this country has approached Africa and, you know, blacks, but it's not today.
Santa Barbara, next. Go ahead, please.
Yes, you know, we had something like this happen in our family corporation with a male adult, about 78 years old, extremely intelligent, dynamic person. As he got older, though, all of a sudden facts weren't being kept straight, and we practically had to go to, as I noticed, the same actions the White House went to, printed speeches. Then I noticed the press was cut off anymore as soon as they put misspoke came out so often, and finally everything was being totally controlled, and it ended up quite tragically. And it seems like this is happening here. Panic's going everywhere, and I think that's why Nancy all of a sudden seems like very bitchy, because the wife had to step in and protect the whole scene because she didn't want, you know, the husband used as a political figure. Also, the thing that scares me most is a little thing that came out in one of the Senate investigating committees about the FBI breaking into churches. There was a question asked, I believe it was Ravel, the FBI, about one of our laws, and he said he couldn't discuss it because it was confidential and restricted. And the committee chairman asked, why? What are you speaking of? And he says, you mean we can't hear the law? And he says, oh, no, sir, the law is clear. That's unclassified. He said it's the interpretation that's classified. And I think that gets down to the basis of what's been happening in our justice and our whole, right down to our Constitution, and even hitting, you know, the ABM treaties here, is that they've taken all of our laws here and redefined them and classified the interpretations until we don't know. And when I heard the president put, the press put to him about the article in the Beirut newspaper, he sat there and laughed at you and said, you gonna believe that? He says, no, that's not true, and would you quit dissembling information in our country?
Okay, Santa Barbara, thank you. Reaction, Bob Parry?
Well, I think the whole question of secrecy does bear on this. The and the Tower Commission report has one recommendation, which I know some people in Congress are not very happy with, and it is that one of the ways to deal with this sort of situation in the future is to have more secrecy. It talks about, instead of having two intelligence committees on the Hill doing oversight, having just one, and making it perhaps less likely that there will be leaks. And it talks about having tighter security in terms of information inside the executive branch. And, you know, clearly there is a need for secrecy on sensitive issues. But the problem that we've seen here, and we've seen it repeatedly over the years with not just this presidency but others, is a tendency to make everything secret or as much secret as possible, because it's easier to deal with if you different actions you're doing if you don't have to explain them. And in this case, the secrecy was wrapped around policies that I don't think the American people would have supported had they known about them, and that Congress wouldn't have supported had it known about it. So the secrecy was used to protect the programs, and it was a shortcut way of doing something without having to explain it to the American public and get support.
Hempstead, New York, for Bob Parry. You're next.
Hi, how are you? I'd like to ask my questions first so that I don't forget. What are the positive things, if in fact this aid was being diverted? Are there positive things? And the other thing I'd like to say to ask you, and if you could just remember these questions, and then I want to make a few statements, is about the press. Do you feel that, I personally feel the press has a little bit too much power. And if you could, I know you addressed it a little bit before, but if you could try to sum this up into some kind of capsule that would express where the how guilty is the press in terms of percentages of making this administration look faulty. First of all, let me now make my statement. Now that I've asked my question, I try and calm down a little bit. I'm a little nervous. I've heard a lot of callers call up with derogatory statements, and it's offensive to me, and I'm hurt. I work on the streets of New York City. I deliver newspapers for a living, and the worst thing I've ever seen in my life is to see someone getting mugged and getting hit while they're down. It's so easy for people to call up, you know, and just jump on the bed. I have faith in this president. People out there do not know what it means to be in the office of president, and they don't understand that every human being has to get, in order to attain the objective, you have to work your way around certain things. I don't want to take up too much time, but when people call up and they're just like me, mud guppies, you know, they may drive a truck or they may be the milkman, and they call up and they say, how can this president do that? I believe we should recognize we voted him in, and we should stand behind him. He represents us, and I'm very offended at people taking cheap shots and not taking into consideration the fact that you don't know how you would approach issues if you were in that situation. This may seem a little radical to get off it a little bit, but the guy that called up about Gaddafi is a guy who trains people to put bombs anywhere. These are Americans that were over in Germany that got blown up. It could have been your family. I'm talking to the guy that called up. And personally, I would take a more drastic stand. I think to get rid of terrorism, they should not only kill the family, they should kill all. Now, this sounds a little crazy, but it would be such a great deterrent. Yeah, so you throw them in jail. They're with all their friends. They're all locked up, and don't worry, they'll take more hostages, and they'll get them out. We're too... We have to fight fire with fire to deter...
Hempstead, we're out of time. Thank you very much for the call.
Well, there's no question that the problem with terrorism and how an advanced society like the United States deals with it is a difficult one. It was it contributed to the bringing down of President Carter, and it has certainly contributed to damage to this president.
He had two questions. The one,
right,
is anything positive that came out of this?
Well, it depends. You know, it depends what side of the issue one's on. It was the view of Colonel North that diverting some of the money from the Iran weapon sales to the Contras was an important step. He included it in the list of accomplishments from the Iran transaction. The idea there, of course, would have been that the Contras were in desperate need of money at the time, and the communications in the Tower Commission bear that out. North was concerned about getting what he called bridge funding for the Contras between that point in the spring of 86 and when they expected Congress to approve the $100 million, which did not happen, as you know, until October of 86. So he was looking for a way to keep that movement afloat, and he used that money, apparently, at least he says he did, to do so. As far as the press making this president look faulty, I would say that my general impression is that the press did not do much to make him look faulty during the 6 years. I mean, there were times when the press would have raised questions about him, but by and large, I think he was treated almost gently by the press.
Our guest for the last hour has been Robert Parry, who is with this magazine, Newsweek. He just came to Newsweek a couple of weeks ago. Prior to that, since 1974, he was with the Associated Press. He is a native of Hartford, Connecticut, not married, graduate of Colby College in Maine in 1971 with a BA in English. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
And to our audience, thank you and for your comments and questions, and have a good day. Center for Neighborhood Enterprise here in Washington, D.C., and Professor Richard Nathan, who is with the Woodrow Wilson School, Princeton University, in Princeton, New Jersey. And then there's a panel beyond that. It looks like they're expected to begin very shortly with Leslie Lenkowski from the Institute for Educational Affairs, Michael Novak, the American Enterprise Institute, Barbara Blum, Foundation for Child Development, New York, New York, and several others. And by the way, later on this morning, the House is expected to come in at noon with no votes or official business on the docket, and the Senate is not expected to return until tomorrow. Senator Moynihan is in the chair. We'll get a closer